Yeah.
Yes, hello to everyone.
Hello.
Welcome to Signal Processing Session of ALECO 2021 Congress. I am very pleased to be with you on such a platform. There are four valuable papers in our session. If you will excuse me, I would like to start the presentation right away. I would like to participant who will present each paper to start by introduce yourself. I think everyone here.
Yes, I think no problem.
First presentation is weighted and label consistent joint sparse hyperspectral image classification. Who will present?
Turgay Dündar. It's minor.
Turgay Dündar. Yes, please.
I will share my screen. Please let me know if any problem occurs, okay?
Yes.
Okay. Can everybody see my presentation? Is there any problem?
No, no problem.
No, okay. Okay, I am Turgay Dündar from the Gaziantep University. The title of my presentation is Weighted and Label Consistent Joint Sparse Hyperspectral Image Classification, which is a very hot topic nowadays. And here is the outline of my presentation. First, I will begin with the introduction. In the introduction part, I will give a brief introduction about hyperspectral imaging, and then some sparse representation based algorithms. And then why we propose our method called weighted and label consistent joint sparse classifier, also WLC GSC. In the second part, I will give the theoretical background about joint sparse representation classifier, and it's followed by proposed weighted and label consistent joint sparse classifier. It's our method. And then I will give some experimental results and then conclusions and references. Okay, what's hyperspectral imaging? Basically, hyperspectral imaging is the process of capturing the reflected sunlight from objects over a broad range of electromagnetic spectrum, which means that we will have many wavelengths. It typically starts from 400 nanometers and goes to 2500 nanometers. And typically, we will have more than 100. Yes.
You can slide presentation change page.
Can you see?
We can't see your presentation.
You will see the topic page or introduction page.
Oh. You are on the first page, right?
I am now in the outline. Can you see?
We cannot see the outline right now.
Okay. No?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. I will not make it full screen. Okay.
It's okay?
I think it's okay.
Yes.
Can you see the slides?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, hyperspectral imaging.
Thank you.
Thank you too. Hyperspectral imaging is the process of capturing reflected sunlight from objects over a broad range of electromagnetic spectrum. As I mentioned before, it covers many wavelengths. It starts from the 400 nanometers and goes up to typically 2500 nanometers. And from the physics, we know that land cover materials absorb and reflect sunlight differently at a specific wavelength. And since we have many wavelengths, it means that these differences make the spectral characteristic of land cover materials also different, which creates a spectral signature. And the use of this principle allows us the classification of hyperspectral image because each material has its own spectral signature. And in this slide, we can see the spectral signatures. For example, if we have an atmosphere, soil, water, or some vegetation, their spectral characteristics will be different. Or we have vegetation, background, soil, alteration, mineral, and man-made material, their spectral characteristics will be different. And this property allows us the classification of the hyperspectral images. And the main task of hyperspectral image classification is to assign an appropriate class label to a given test sample. Okay, we will have some trained samples and we will have some test samples. Our aim is to assign an appropriate class label to a given test samples. And early classification algorithms use only the spectral information. Okay, in a hyperspectral image, we have two informations. The first one is spectral and the second one is the spatial information. Spectral information means the band information, but the spatial information gives the neighborhood information of pixels. And the early classification algorithms use only spectral information such as spot vector machines, k-nearest neighbors, and sparse representation classifier. Among them, sparse representation-based classifier has attracted much attention. According to the sparse representation classifier, the test sample can be represented by only a few trained sample in trained dictionary. So it encodes the sparse of the coefficient vector and attracts much attention in the literature. And also in the work in tree, they also propose joint sparse representation classifier, which uses spatial correlation of neighbor pixels. It uses both of the spectral and the spatial correlation. And our method is based on this method. In GSRC, it is assumed that the contribution of all neighbor pixels to the classification process is equal. And this assumption causes misclassification of some patches. In GSRC, we will, for example, we have a test sample. We will create a square patch around this test sample. For example, 3x3 or 5x5 or 7x7. And it's assumed that the contribution of all these neighbor pixels are equal. However, it is not true because in some patches, it may be included in other classes and this will cause misclassification. In the literature, there are some several studies to overcome this problem. For example, in paper 6 and 7, also they are also my papers. In 6, it applies different spectral matching methods to central pixel and its neighbors. And according to the results of these spectral matching methods, it eliminates or selects some neighbor samples and increases the classification result of GSRC. And also in the work in 7, it uses both spectral and coordinate information of neighbor samples to choose or discard the neighbor samples. And also work in 8, an unlocal weighted joint sparse representation classifier assigns different weights to each neighbor pixel of a test sample using a non-local weighting shape. It selects a patch and also it sorts some non-local patches. And using this property, it assigns different weights to each neighbor samples and it increases the classification results of GSRC. And a weighted function is utilized to measure the similarity of test sample and its neighbors in weighted joint nearest neighbor and sparse representation, also VWGJNMGSR. It also uses the weight function. And also in GSRC, we calculate the residual value after the sparse matrix coefficient is obtained. I will give theoretical background in section 2. And also there are some studies which incorporate the similarity of test and train samples into the residual calculation, which is also known as label consistent property. Joint sparse representation based nearest neighbor GSRNM evaluates p largest coefficients for each class in sparse coefficient matrix and finds the average of the coefficients. Then class label of a given test sample is determined as the class with maximum average coefficients. And also it increases the classification results of GSRC. And in addition to this work, correlation coefficient joint sparse representation, CSCCR, GSR, calculates the correlation coefficient between a test sample and all trained samples. Then they use these coefficients to combine the residual calculation as a regularization parameter. And it's observed that the results are increased according based on the GSRC. Okay, we propose WLC, GSC which combines both weight assignment to neighbors of a test sample and label consistency of trained samples. We incorporated both of these methods. The following steps are applied. In step one, we extract a square patch in hyperspectral image. We select, for example, we select the test sample and we extract a square patch around this test sample. In step two, we calculate the similarities of central test sample and its neighbors using a Gaussian weight function. In step three, we select or discard some neighbors because we assign some weights, and according to these weights, we select or discard some neighbors. And step four, we evaluate the sparse coefficient matrix using simultaneous orthogonal matching cross-set optimization algorithm. And in step five, we incorporate the similarities of selected samples, neighbor samples, and the trained samples, which is also known as label consistency property. Okay, I will give some theoretical background about drawing sparse representation classifiers. Before starting, we should consider the following symbols. An hyperspectral data cube can have a size of, for example, U by V by B. Because it is a cube, it should have three dimensions. And also, we can represent it in two-dimensional form, like B by M, where here B represents the number of spectral bands, and M is equal to U multiplied by V, denotes the number of pixels in hyperspectral image. And before the classification process, we should normalize each column of hash to zero between one, which will have, we should have the unity norm. And this process is done for all classification process. If you are using machine learning or deep learning, you have to done this step. And also, as I mentioned before, we should have trained samples and test samples. We will divide this hash into trained and test samples. A random selected trained dictionary with C classes, for example, we have 10 classes, the C will equal to 10, or we have 16 classes, the C will be equal to 16. A random selected trained dictionary with C classes is represented as B, which has a size of B by N. Again, B represents the number of spectral bands, and N represents the total number of trained samples. Since we have C classes, each class have NC samples. So N is equal to N1 plus N2 plus N3, and it goes up to NC. And also, we will have an S, S1, S2, and ST. ST represents the spectral values of a test sample. And each of S1, S2, and goes up to ST represents the neighbor of the test samples. And with a size of B by K, where K represents the number of neighbor samples, including the test sample. This joint matrix that specifies a test sample, ST, and its spatial neighbors. Okay. In joint sparse representation classifier, it is assumed that this S can be sparsely and linearly represented by a set of common atoms in D. So we should have such an equation like S is equal to D multiplied by A. A is the sparse coefficient matrix. S is equal to D multiplied by A plus some error. We should minimize the error to have linear representation. So we should minimize argument minimum S minus DA. We should take the Frobenius norm. Frobenius norm calculates the approximation errors. And in the other side, we should have an A.
Dear Tuğçe, Tuğçe'm.
Yes.
Time is running out. Can you be faster, please?
Okay. We will have such an equation like one, and we have to solve this problem using simultaneous orthogonal matching crossing algorithm. After we use some we will obtain the sparse Gaussian matrix, and after that we should calculate its residual. And according to the residual, the class, the label of the test sample will be a class with residual, with minimum residual value. In our proposed method, again, suppose that we have an S and the weight W between ST and its neighbors is calculated using the equation 4. It's a Gaussian weight function. After that, we will obtain some weights. And after all the weight values are obtained, the weights are rearranged according to the two thresholds called the W low and W high. We will use this equation 5. And then a diagonal weight matrix W, whose diagonal elements are composed of rearranged values in equation 5. And we will construct a W in equation 6. Once W is obtained, the weights are embedded into the matrix S, and a weighted spatial matrix SW is calculated using equation 7. In equation 7, some of the columns will be completely zero because of the zero weights obtained in equation 5. And such columns should be extracted from SW to eliminate irrelevant neighbors of ST. After excluding the neighbors with no impact, any spatial joint matrix is formed as SW tilde. And since the original joint matrix S is multiplied by W, the columns are no longer have a unit norm. So a normalization process is required to have columns with unit norm. We should down equation 8. And the next step is the calculation of the sparse Gaussian matrix as in GSRC. For label consistency, we should average the train samples in each class using equation 10. And the similarity matrix WC between D mean and SW will be calculated as equation using equation 11. And in equation 11, each column of WC denotes the similarities between a sample in SW tilde and average of train samples belonging to each class. And each row of WC represents the similarities between all samples in SW tilde and average the train samples in a certain class. And in order to multiply element-wise, size of the two matrices should be equal. We know this property. So while calculating the residual value, the corresponding row of the WSIM is expanded and replicated as number of rows in P in the related class. Finally, we should calculate the residual and find the class table using equation 12 and 13. And here is the flow chart or our proposed method. We have an hyperspectral data cube, neighborhood matrix. We should calculate the sparse Gaussian matrix after obtaining the weights. And then we again apply Gaussian weight function between average class samples of train dictionary and each weight sample in the window. And we will construct the similarity matrix. And then we calculate the residual. And then we should multiply using weights. And then for each test sample, we should repeat these steps and obtain the classification maps. Experiments are conducted on a well-known hyperspectral image dataset called Indian Pines. The properties are, it's a size of 145 by 145 by 220, where 145 by 145 is the spatial dimension, and 220 is the spectral dimension. However, 20 spectral channels between this range are removed due to the water absorption and noise according to the reference 12. And therefore, the data with a size of 145 by 145 by 200 is used. And this data consists of 16 land cover class and mostly contains agricultural products. And this map shows the ground truth, and this shows the class names. And we can see the last class descriptions. We have 16 classes. Here is our name. And this site shows the number of samples. And this here shows the total number of samples. We compare our methods with SVM, CRC, GSRC, GSR-NM, NLV-GSRC, and CC-GSR. The classification performance is analyzed in terms of four metrics such as overall accuracy, average accuracy, kappa statistics, and class-specific accuracy results. These metrics are evaluated from the confusion matrix. For example, if we have two classes, like class 1 and class 2, it will have a confusion matrix like this. And according to these values, we can obtain overall accuracy, which is defined as number of test samples classified correctly divided by total number of test samples. And class accuracy means that number of test samples classified correctly in the related class divided by total number of test samples in the related class. And average accuracy means that sum of the classification accuracies, for example, CA1 plus CA2, and divided by the total number of the classes, CA1 plus CA2 divided by 2. And kappa statistics is observed as observed accuracy minus expected accuracy divided by 1 minus expected accuracy. And the parameters of methods to be compared are adjusted as determined by the authors of the original papers.
Mr. Dündar, last three
minutes. Okay. Our method have 5 parameters to be obtained, like sparse level, window size, control parameter, and 2 thresholds. In order to determine, we fix the K and sigma by 5x5 and 0.5, and then we select some sparse levels and some weight thresholds. And according to this figure, we select the sparse level 2, V log is equal to 0.8, and V high is equal to 0.95. And we randomly select 10% samples in each class as 3, and the rest of is separated as test samples. We repeat the experiment 10 times because we randomly select the trained samples. Because of this, we repeat the experiments 10 times and then average the results of each method under comparison due to the randomly chosen trained samples. And we can see the classification accuracy results here. And the highest results are bolded and the second highest results are underlined. As we can see, our proposed methods have such an accuracy or overall accuracy, average accuracy, and kappa statistic. This is the highest results. And here we can see the classification maps. As we see, SVM and CRC sparse representation classifier depends on only spectral information. Their classification maps looks noisy, but other maps use spatial plus spectral information. Their classification maps looks well compared to the SVM and CRC. In the conclusion part, based on label consistent joint sparse representation based classifiers proposed, VL's local weighting scheme is used to assign an appropriate weight to each neighbor of a test sample in a local patch, and resemblance between the average trained samples and samples in the window are obtained, and these similarities are incorporated into the residual calculation, and quantitative experimental results indicate that the proposed WLC GSC outperforms to similar state of the art algorithm in the literature. And here's the references and the end of the presentation. Okay. Thank you for listening to everyone. If you have any questions,
thank you for this presentation.
I think too.
Time is up, but I can get a question if any.
Yes. I think no.
Yes. Thank you.
Okay. I think it too.
Dash.
Okay. I think it too.
Second presentation is driver drawness detection using mobile net and long short time memory.
Yes, I will share screen.
Okay, please get started.
Sure.
Please try to complete the presentation in 50 minutes. Okay.
Can you see my presentation?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Hello everyone, my name is Adem Avcı. I'm a research assistant at Bursa Technical University. I'm a PhD student in electrical engineering. Today I will present our study driver drowsiness detection using mobile nets and long short-term memory. Driver drowsiness occurs in the case of sleepiness or fatigue that might be dangerous for both the passengers and people around the vehicle. For this reason, it is important to detect driver drowsiness in order to prevent traffic accident and unattributed death. Although smart driver systems have become a part of life with a developing technology, but they are not widely used. In the literature, driver drowsiness has been tried to determine accurately with indirect or direct measurement methods. With the latest technological developments in deep learning and computational power, driver drowsiness can be detected more accurately and effectively. In the literature, three different measurement methods are used to detection of drowsiness. These are done with physiological measurements, vehicle-based measurements, and measurements of the driver behavior. It has been studied on the detection of drowsiness from the physiological signals obtained with electrodes attached to the driver. The feature obtained by processing these signals, such as EMG, ECG, EEG, are used in machine learning algorithms. The behaviors of the vehicle and driver are examined from the signals received from the vehicle. Drowsiness detection studies are carried out with the change of driving speed, the brake patterns, or the position change in the line. In the literature, most studies are carried out behavioral measurements with the help of a camera that monitors the driver, change in the eye, mouth, and head movements are emphasized. In this way, yawning, head falling forward, or change in blinking patterns that occurs in the case of drowsiness are detected. This feature obtains from each frame in the videos are used in driver drowsiness detection with machine learning algorithms or rule-based algorithms. These features obtained from each frame in videos are used in driver drowsiness detection with machine learning algorithms or rule-based algorithms. In each image, the facial features of the driver are determined by image processing techniques, and eye, mouth, and head movements are followed throughout the video to form a decision mechanism. With the latest developments in deep learning techniques, this feature extraction and decision mechanism can be made more effective and accurate. In this study, the NTHU 3D, which has created synthetically in the laboratories laboratories of National Teaching Hua University was used. These data sets consist of video recordings obtained from 36 drivers of different ethnicities and genders. These video recordings have a resolution of 418 by 640. While creating the dataset, five different scenarios were tried to be imitated in order to create a real driving experience. This scenario consists of without glasses, with glasses and sunglasses during the daytime, and with and without glasses at nighttime. In addition, nighttime videos are recorded at 15 frames per second, while other videos were recorded at 30 FPS. As stated in the table, the data set divided into three as training, validation, and testing. The training data set points of 18 drivers and 90 video recordings. The validation data set of 4 drivers and video 20 video recordings. The last test data set consists of 14 drivers and 70 video recordings. Sample images of the data set are shown. Drivers of different ethnicities and different genders were recorded in the laboratory environment. Drivers exhibited behaviors that mimic drowsiness and generated normal and drowsiness data for different scenarios. As we mentioned before, there are video recordings with different FPS. Video sampling has been reduced to 5 FPS in order to export all videos to the proposed deep learning algorithm to detect drowsiness quickly and to use memory optimally. We did it to decrease computational cost and memory need to edge device. Using frame grabber, we focus on face in individual frames. Face detection was performed on each image using the daylib library. When a face is found in the images, the region of interest is cut and resized to 112 by 112. If a face cannot detect an image, the whole image is resized to 112 by 112, so that the flow is not disturbed. The resulting region of interest are given as input the proposed model. Transfer learning was used in the first part of the proposed model. The mobile net structure is given in the table. With mobile nets, feature extraction is made from each image in the video. Mobile net was chosen because it has fewer parameters than others transfer learning methods. In addition, with the good results obtained, the ImageNet competition, better feature extraction can be made compared to normal CNN structure. Since the inputs of proposed model were resized as 112 by 112, the mobile net inputs were changed accordingly. In addition, since the mobile net structure is used feature extraction, the outputs of the last pooling layer are taken. First of all, every image in the video is pre-processed. Afterwards, the resized image are given as input to mobile net network for feature extraction according to problem. At the output of this network structure, 1,024 features are obtained. The LSTM network is used to exploit the temporal information of historical images. Thus, special feature obtained from the transferred CNN blocks, temporal information between the video frames are captured with the help of LSTM network. In the proposed model, two LSTM layers consist of 64 and 32 blocks are used. In the last layer, a single neuron with sigmoid activation function is used. Thus, the model output is binary set, is a drowsy and not drowsy. The L value is L value shown in the figure represent how many frames are given as input to the LSTM layers. The results were obtained by increasing the L value from 5 to 20 by 5. The ADAM optimizer was used to train the proposed model. Since the model output, the actual output values are binary, the binary cross entropy loss function is used. The model has the model was trained at the specific learning rate for thirty-five epochs. In addition, the batch size was chosen as 8, thus accelerating the training. Due to large data size and inefficient memory, the base size was not increased further. In the table, the results obtained according to different frame lengths, namely amount of frames given the given to the LSTM network are given. It seems the best results in accuracy, F1 score, and the other values are obtained at 15 frame lengths. In the table here, the results of the proposed model are compared to the previous study in the literature. In the study with proposed lightweight model was obtained efficient performance despite the disadvantage of preferring DALIP to DALIP library to detect faces. The transferred CNN LSTM model has achieved good results compared to many other many models in the literature. However, it has been observed in the literature that is slightly below the best results. State-of-art models are computationally heavy and cannot be implemented in the low-cost processing processing device for mobile applications. Hierarchical CNN LSTM-based model provides detection performance slightly inferior to state of the art deep learning models, whereas it is computational advantages over those models. Also, we implement this model on commercial board Raspberry Pi 4 with a low frame rate like 5 to 10 FPS with a resolution for 180 times 640. It was an important step for us to apply this method on a commercial card for future real-time studies. The proposed model can be further improved in two ways. Firstly, rather than using DALIP for face detection, some other methods like pre-trained deep learning models can be used to detect faces more accurately in grouped frames. Moreover, developing a new head detection algorithms would be more efficient since the driver pose varies a lot in training videos. Secondly, rather than utilizing ImageNet to train the transferred CNN model parameters, a more relevant network trained on the dataset related human face and postures can be used. If good results are obtained in the studies to be done, real-time projects can be realized in public transportation and private vehicles. Thank you for listening.
Yes, Mr. Avcı. Thank you for this nice presentation.
Yes.
Have a question. There are 2 minutes. I think. No.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Third presentation classification of EEG signals in neuromarketing implementation task. Yes, here yes, you are.
Me. Hello.
Samet Oran, here you are.
I will share the screen right away. Could you see the slide?
Yes, that's okay.
That's no problem.
Okay, just a second.
Get started, please.
Hello, everyone. It is a privilege to speak with you today. Well, let me introduce myself. My name is Samet Oran. I am a master of student at Adana Science and Technology University. I'm here today to present our research on classification of EEG signals in neuromarketing implementation tests. My presentation, I hopefully will take 15 minutes, and there will be time for the question after my presentation. Well, let's get started. This presentation is structured as follows. What is neuromarketing and marketing? And then I will move on to a brief history of the neuromarketing. Right after that, I will go on to highlight what I see as the main points of neuromarketing implementation test. And finally, I will describe the results of our research. Let's start off the main definitions. Marketing and promotions of various consumer products through advertisement campaigns is a well-known practice to increase sales and awareness amongst the consumers. Strongly fortified by multiple disciplines such as business economics and engineering, marketing is a robust and continually evolving field in which consumers are playing a prominent role through their participation in the process of products. However, knowing consumer preferences for decision making and behavior prediction for effective utilization of a product using unconscious processes is called neuromarketing. Merging neuromarketing and marketing entails combining two areas of study. This is neuroscience and marketing. It can be said that neuromarketing brings some similarities with neuropsychology and psychology. For instance, psychology helps to better understand mental problems. Correlatively, neuropsychology gets an understanding of customer needs. But the primary differences between them is neuropsychology studies the brain-human linkage, while neuromarketing validates the importance of seeing customer behavior from a brain perspective. This definition is a consumer-oriented product selling method that uses non-invasive brain signal recording techniques such as electroencephalography, positron emission tomography, and functional magnetic resonance imaging. EEG is a powerful tool to measure neural signals to gain insight into customers' preferences and create new sales strategies. Important benefits such as low cost and high temporal resolution have brought EEG to the forefront of scientific research in this field. To briefly talk about the history of neuromarketing, Reid Montague, professor of neuroscience at Baylor College of Medicine, conducted the first scientific piece of neuromarketing study in 2003. A group of participants was instructed to consume Pepsi or Coca-Cola while their brains were examined by an fMRI scan. A few US firms such as SalesCram and Bright House led to neuromarketing researches and advisory services. So far, I am shown that what neuromarketing is, how it works for marketing, and its history. Now, I'm going to give you a summary, and then I'm going to elaborate on the work. Our work aims to link between advertising products and the human brain to understand which product participants like or dislike while they look at e-commerce goods by using EEG signals. Now, we may examine our work through four main headings. First of all, the main part is organizing EEG sample. This title followed by EEG recordings and e-commerce test supplements. Secondly, feature extraction, to extract sample features with sliding window and continuous Fourier transform. And then classification, in this part, we classify extracted samples with KNN and random forest algorithm. And finally, the classification analysis results were collected as regards to accuracy rate. Now let's start with explaining EEG recording. The data set was accumulated 25 participants to examine EEG relation with mental activity during e-commerce test recorded. The EEG signals were observed with 14-channel emotive EPAC plus sensor. Each record contained 4-second EEG segments, and this EEG data was recording at a sample rate of 128 hertz. The sample rate in terms of hertz is equivalent to 1 set, by the way. In this work, we created product sets shown in the table, consists of 42 digital images, divided into 14 categories with 3 samples per category. As you can see, 3 products from the same category are shown, like 3 shoes, 3 watches, and 3 ties, exactly. 25 participants are asked independently to analyze each category of 4 seconds during the collection of the EEG data and at the end of the EEG. In 4 second period, participants were asked whether they like or didn't like products present to them. As a result, each subject has a total 42 different EEG data from different products as shown in the table. The next main heading is feature extraction. Feature extraction is the most important part of the process where raw signals are mainly routed. Here, the signals can be evolved in following desired criteria or methods. EEG signals are segmented with the sliding window technique. The feature extraction is made from PERL or each segments with continuous wavelet transform. The first subheading of feature extraction is the sliding window. So what is sliding window? This method has been employed in numerous research since the feature segments are processed more precisely without missing any information due to overlap. Achieve ideal circumstances in a specific time gap by taking a subarray of data from a given feature array and expanding or contracting that subarray. The figure shows that the example of a sliding window overlap illustration for a 500 millisecond segment. In our work, when using the sliding window technique, each subject has a data duration of 4 seconds, and each window is segmented into 0.5, 1, and 2 seconds. The existence of different segments lengths notably affects the accuracy of results. While doing the sliding window analysis, features were collected from each segment, and a 50% overlap ratio was utilized. The most important part is continuous wavelet transform. The wavelet technique, which is commonly used in EEG analysis, provides information on the correlation between the wavelet and the recording the EEG raw data array. In the 19-channel recorded EEG dataset, features were picked from 4 bands, namely theta, alpha, beta, and gamma. The signals were analyzed in 4 frequency bands covering the wavelet power spectrum. Both the segment length and overlap ratio were utilized as factors and base throughout this extraction. The formula for extraction EEG characteristics is shown. The features extracted in this formula are located in channels and bands. J indicates the number of channels, which is 19, and I indicates the number of bands in each channel. Fij denotes the extracted feature of the J-th channel and I-th subband. Sj denotes the wavelet spectrum of the J-th channel from the EEG segment. Here, each brainwave represents of, we talk about alpha, beta, and gamma. And based on this, we can say that there are 4 bands. On the other hand, since the EEG recording has 19 channels, our number J is 19. As a result, the total number of features for a person is calculated by multiplying of channels with bands, and result is found 56. The classification part. In this part, after the power spectrum processes, the segment features obtained were classified by KNN and random forest algorithms, which are often used in EEG signals analysis, were applied in classification tasks for extracted features. The Waikato environment for knowledge analysis was used to perform the KNN and random forest algorithm classify data set features. Most of you maybe know the Waikato program, maybe used. The first classification algorithm is KNN. KNN is a machine learning algorithm. It is widely used since 19th century to analyze data in supervised environments. The key refers to the number of nearest neighbor used to classify outcomes in a data set. The classification of each new observation is calculated based on distance determined by weighted averages. The random forest. Random forest is an effective supervised learning approach. It constructs and combines decision trees to form a forest. Because there is more than one decision tree created, the likelihood of classification success is great. Although a large number of decision trees produces better classification results, a restriction should be maintained on the number of randomly produced decision trees. Otherwise, the algorithm will be faced with an overfitting problem. I want to explain the definition of overfitting for someone who is not familiar with it. In data science, overfitting occurs when a statistical model fits exactly training data, but this perfection gives more degree and complexity to the system. Therefore, it is unable to generalize well to new data. This is the most general problem. The results sections, the table shows the KNN and random forest algorithms on classification accuracy results. The data obtained from 25 subjects results are determined using the wake-up program. When the table is analyzed, it is seen that the highest accuracy of 7.24 with KNN observed on the 2 second sample length, while lowest accuracy of 67.5 with random forest observed on the 0.5 second sample length. Looking at the overall result, as the length of EEG signal processed for the extraction increased, it had positive effect on the accuracy result. However, since the positive effect cannot be as efficient as the previous one after a certain point, this direct ratio cannot be completely accepted. Considering this situation, the percentage increase to be obtained length of signals not proportional. This explanation also varies according to type of classifier applied. It is seen that it works on KNN classifier used in this study. The same results cannot be observed, as I mentioned before. KNN has a much positive effect than random forest in this table. Overall, the accuracy results are shown in this study also highlight that EEG features processed in wavelet wavelet transform together with sample length parameter gave satisfactory accuracy values in KNN and random forest classifiers. Thank you for listening to me. If you have any questions, I will be glad to answer it.
Thank you for this nice presentation, Samet Orhan. I have a question.
Thank you. Thank you.
The subject is very popular.
Is this a question? I missed it.
The subject is very popular. I want to question. Okay.
Of course, of course. Of course. Let me.
Do you want to continue with this subject?
May I continue with this subject? No. This is the raw data set. For some of the participants, but I want to go ahead with this, what different subjects or most of this subject is familiar with this title, but I want to develop and forefront to the neuromarketing process.
Yes, okay. You can increase it data for different pictures.
Mm-hmm. Yes, this maybe. Is also it may appear.
Maybe.
Yes. Yes. Okay. Thank you.
Are there any questions?
No, okay.
Thank you again.
Thanks.
Last presentation is deep computer-based pre-diagnosis from chest CTs of COVID-19 patients?
Yes. I will share my screen. Yes, I will share my screen.
Okay.
Can you see?
That's okay.
Okay. Sorry. Yes. My name is Berkan Ural. I have been working as an assistant professor in Kafkas University. My presentation is deep computer-based pre-diagnosis from chest CTs of COVID-19 patients. Since approximately December, some patients who have pneumonia with fever, cough, and dyspnea have found in Wuhan, China. And this disease has been diagnosed as beta coronavirus on February. Then the WHO officially declared is the coronavirus disease. For the detection phase, in addition to get positive virus tests, the radiological imaging like chest X-ray and CT are also prominent for obtaining and analyzing the pneumonia pattern in the lungs. The first technique is the X-ray imaging. This technique is so faster, easier, and cheaper, but there may be some failure to effectively recognize and diagnose this disease. The other technique is the CT imaging technique. The computerized tomography has generally used as one of the common methods to diagnose pneumonia, and deep learning-based automated CT image analysis for the detection, interpretation, and analyzing the coronavirus and to distinguish infected patients from the others. For the proposed study, we have proposed a computer-based biomedical diagnosis approach that consists from automated detection with specific image processing methods and deep analysis on chest CT data with popular and hybrid methods for AI and DL deep learning models. This study was achieved with the MATLAB, the last version, and convolutional neural network and disk-based models, and the hybrid version of the CNN GA were chosen and used. And also for the AI part, the ANN and the Levenberg-Marquardt algorithm, the hybrid method was used too. The novelty of this work can be summarized as, according to the MATLAB CNN-motivated deep convolutional neural network models, these models are can be said that the pre-trained models, and the pre-trained models can give us to obtain more successful results in the specific data sets. For this study, the CT images were chosen from the GPALCOM from University of Montreal, and these images belongs to the COVID-19 patients in the worldwide. Totally 1,000 images were chosen and used in the study. Indeed, patients with COVID who were diagnosed from January to August 2020 were used in this retrospective study. There was not any specific inclusion criteria too. In the methodology part, with using MATLAB,
The proposed study consisted from two fundamental parts, was a computer-based preliminary diagnosis approach that allows for fast detection, early interpretation, and accurate prediction for the for this disease. The goal of the approach was helping doctors and the other scientists optimally with a support mechanism. Indeed, the first part is the abnormal area with using specific common image processing methods. Then the other part was interpretation and prediction of the CT data with using the ANN with LM algorithm and three different deep learning based models. This is the flowchart of our algorithm. There are two main parts. The first part is the image processing, and the other part is the deep learning part. The sample chest CTs belong to this study, like given in the right side of the page. The first one is the healthy, and the other one is the infected chest CT. The first part is the image processing part. In this stage, chest CT images were rebalanced according to the parameters of contrast and brightness. For this case, 2D discrete wavelet transform was used for obtaining the contrast feature of the images. For this reason, the gray matrix was obtained with the contrast value from the gray level images. Then for all images, the contrast and brightness level was get a specific value feed like given in 208, and this value was obtained after many practice. So dark images were obtained in the brighter versions at the end of the process. In the DVT decomposition part, the main idea of DVT was to provide the representation of time and resolution properties. For the DVT, we use the shifting and dilating information functions and also the scaling functions, and that form an orthonormal basis. And also for the decomposition models, we use some wavelet or subbands. In the thresholding part, for gray images, the optimal value for better thresholding was obtained, and this value was obtained as 86. With this value, the color-based gray level thresholding has achieved successfully according to the equation tree. Then the morphological operations were achieved. In this step, a specifically defined structure element was chosen and used. The reason for choosing the disk type is the circle shape of the whole lung in CT. Then this image was divided into two equal parts vertically according to the coordinates of the lung, and the roids. And the ROIs were obtained in detail. In the analyze interpretation by NNN part is, when we look at the whole results, the best of the results are obtained from the first part is Levenberg-Marquardt method. In the deep learning part, we use three different models, two models and one hybrid model. The hybrid version of the model was based on the semantic diagram in the feature. Also, the training data we used is used with 120 epochs and the base size of 40, and the learning rate is like that. And some of the images were used for the training phase, and the others are used for the test phase. When we look at the results, the results of AlexNet, yani the CNN based of AlexNet is given, and the loss function is given in the figure. The results of the ResNet 50 is given like that. When we look at the rock analysis, the ANN and LM algorithms result was obtained as the best result. Then the AlexNet part was more higher than the other parts, and the least success was obtained from the AlexNet part. In conclusion, there were some limitations in the presented study. We did not have all the CT scan data of every patient. So if we had, we could achieve some more successful obtaining parameters. With using the limited data of the limited number of data, we used pre-trained deep learning models for fast detection and the accurate evaluation. Finally, I'm the main author of the study from Kafkasya University. Thank you for listening. I cannot hear you.
Excuse me. Thank you for this nice presentation, Berkan. That's okay. Any question? I think we have 3 minutes. You can questions.
I can ask a small question.
Yes.
As I understand, you binarized the medical images, right?
Yes.
But for example, if you can open the lungs, left and right lungs, in the binary version. No. Yes, this one.
Uh-huh.
And here, the left and right lungs are binary. It's okay. But however, the other sides are also zero values. And also inside lungs, we have again zero values.
Mm-hmm.
And the AlexNet or the ResNet will analyze all the image, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the other parts of lungs, we have also zeros, and inside the parts, inside the lungs, we have also zeros. I think this makes the misclassification of some samples. I said it like a study in my PhD lecture as a project. I used the RGB images, and I obtained approximately 97 or 98 if I use RGB mix instead of binary version of the lungs. And I can give a suggestion to you. If you can use RGB version, I think you can obtain better classification accuracy.
Yes, we can upgrade this study as a project with using the lung spectrogram images for the DL part.
Mm-hmm.
And also with using the RGB images, When we use the spectrogram images, we believe that we will have much more success than the RGB images.
Mm-hmm. Because binary version of the image have only one chance, mm-hmm. RGB is three chances, and if you use a better version of RGB...
And the spectrogram chance. Has four channels, okay. And there will have more successful mm-hmm. results for this.
Yes, in image classification task, if we have more channels, we will obtain much better results.
Mm-hmm.
I want to give a suggestion, just this is okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for your presentation and all the presenters.
Thank you like to take for all these the... questions, Mr. Dündar. Okay. Yes, other question? Are there?
No, but it's a good presentation. I think that's are you welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, our session ended here. thank you very much, everyone, for your valuable works. I pleased to meet. Yes, I think we can end the session.
Okay.
Thank you for
okay. you. We thank you too.
We can go. Okay.
Yes. Thank you.
Thank you. Goodbye, everyone.